Hello. Today, by the end of this lecture, we will understand the objects of Kombar preparatory. So, the reasons for combing. Let us see why do we exactly go for a combing process. It's supposed to be an optional process. We can always produce carded yarns, but if we want a better quality of yarn, then we go for Kombar as an as a process. So why, what is the reason for going for combing? So we already know that there is a lot of variation in fiber length that we see, and this can be shown in the form of a bare sorted diagram, which we have already studied in the previous lectures. So fiber length influences many factors related to yarn quality, like yarn strength, yarn hairiness, but the one that in discussion is yarn evenness. So fiber length exhibits the greatest irregularity of all fiber characteristics. Therefore, the problem that it gives in the drafting operation, this also we have seen earlier, that it leads to an increase in unevenness. To obtain an absolutely regular yarn, of all fiber characteristics have to be uniformly distributed over the entire length of yarn. So this is a prerequisite to form a very, very regular yarn, that all your fiber characteristics must be uniformly distributed, and all those fibers should be uniformly distributed again over the entire length of the yarn. But such a situation is not possible due to the variations that is there, that we find in fiber properties, and also due to the mechanical constraints like difficulty in controlling the movement of short fibers by the drafting rollers. Because of both these reasons, we find that we cannot really have a very, very regular yarn. So a better way is to look at the proportion of short fibers and reduce them. The proportion of short fibers has to be evaluated from the staple diagram or the bare sorted diagram, but it may be specified as a percentage of fibers shorter than 12 or 12.5 mm. So all the fibers that are below 12 or 12.5 mm would be normally considered as a short fiber. The short fibers that are there will also lead to a lot of fly contamination, and therefore it is a strain on the personal, machine, workroom, and also the air conditioning, along with the above mentioned drafting difficulties. So it means that not only creates a problem in the quality of the yarn that is produced, but it also gives create certain problems, like it will affect the personnel that is working, the machine, as well as the workroom. So due to all these reasons, the proportion of short fibers increases considerably due to the mechanical picking. Now the reason for having a lot of short fibers is that because it goes back into picking process. There, if we are using a mechanical picking system, then you will see a lot of short fibers in your material. And also, if there are hard ginning practices that are followed, then you will again find a lot of short fibers in your cotton. So removal of these short fibers or eliminating them becomes very important. So this removal can only happen by the combing process. So combing is a process that removes short fibers. And by looking at the bare sorted diagram, we can say that this area that is marked here by green, this is the fibers that would create a lot of problem, and it would normally be below 12 mm in length, 12.5. And looking at the staple diagram, we can always for different cottons the staple diagram would differ, and this proportion can always be calculated. It may not be strictly 12 or 12.5. It all depends on the staple diagram that we get. So now coming to the processing lines, let us see how the processing line would change if Kombar was a part of it. So this is the processing line for a simple carded yarn. So after blowroom, which is there before this, the material comes to card, then it will go to the draw frame, then it will go to the two passages of draw frame, and then it will go to this roving frame and ring frame. So this is normal process that would give us a carded yarn. So now here, when you come to the processing line which is used for combed yarn, what is done is this particular one draw frame that is there over here would be entirely replaced by three machines over here, and this would be Combar preparatory and Combar. So 2 and 3 are the Combar preparatory and 4 would be the Combar here. So this entire set would, it is as if you have added this at this place. So after card you would have Combar and Combar preparatory. Then the same thing follows, that your same passage of draw frame, then roving frame and ring frame. So this would be your passage for carded yarn and this would be for combed yarn. So coming to the basic steps in combing, we need to understand the basic steps in combing before we understand why the Combar preparatory needs to do what it needs to do. So let us see the basic steps that are involved. So we already know that Combar removes short fibers. So how do we remove them? So this would be the steps that are involved in combing. There would be a fiber tuft. Then the fiber tuft would be first gripped and combed. And then you would have a second grip, which you will keep at the distance from the first grip. And again, comb it and then remove the first grip. And so then after that, comb again to remove the fiber shorter than the set distance in step 3. Maybe these steps have not been understood very clearly. So let us look at the diagrammatic or the diagram for it, or pictorially let us try to explain. So this is the fiber tuft where you will find all entangled and fibers that are in this fashion. Then the second step would be to first take these fibers, have a grip here, which can be seen as a pink line over here, where the fibers are gripped and they are combed. Once they're combed, you will have a situation like this, where most of the fibers are, you know, parallel and held on one side by the grip. So once this is done, what we do is place a second grip at a certain distance from the first grip, that is this blue grip, which you can see a line has come here. So we have placed this grip at a certain distance from the first one, and this distance would be decided by how much, what length of fibers I would like to pass in the sliver and which fibers I would like to eliminate. So depending on that, this will be placed at that particular distance. And once this is done, what I will do is I will remove the first grip. As you can see, the pink grip has gone. So now one important observation here, that whichever long fibers were there, which were longer than this particular distance that we have set between the two grips, only those fibers will be gripped here, as you can see. And all the other fibers which were not able to reach the second grip will be left like this. Now, only thing that we need to do is just comb off this rear end, and what you get is a fiber tuft in this grip, where all the fibers will be longer than the distance that we have set. So I hope this entire steps are clear. So now let us go on to understand the technical names that are given to all these things in the actual combing process. So we need to remember these terms here. The first grip that is there would be called as nippers. And we need to comb this after holding them. So the first comb that we use would be the cylinder. So these two functions, the gripping and the combing, are done by these two parts on the Combar machine, that is nippers and cylinder. So coming to the second grip that we place, or that we placed in the earlier steps of ours. So this particular second grip would be called as a detaching roller in case of Combar. So once this, after this step 3, in the step 4, the grip will be removed. That means the nippers will open in this case. And what we do is we need a second comb that will comb this rear end to remove these particular fibers which are short. So the second comb would be called as a top comb. So as you can see, these are the major parts, or the important parts that we need to remember. That is the nippers, cylinder, the detaching roller and the top comb. So once all these steps are done, we get a tuft that has all the fibers longer than the set distance. So once these steps are understood, let us go on to see how an actual Combar animation, it is an animation, how a Combar functions.
Although mechanically complicated, the purpose of the combing process is really quite simple. Combing removes short fibers from the yarn making process. Depending on the cotton fiber being combed and the settings of the comber itself, short can have more than one meaning, but generally it means fibers that are 1/2 inch or less in length. The percentage of these fibers removed can vary greatly, again depending on the cotton being used and the settings of the comber. The combing process starts by preparing what is known as a lap. This is simply a number of individual, once-drawn slivers that are wound into a ribbon-like fashion onto a spool. This wound lap becomes the input for the combing process. For each combing cycle, a measured amount of the lap is fed out and held fast for the pass of the half lap. The half lap is a wire or needle-covered section mounted on a rotating shaft that passes its teeth or needles through the held beard, the measured lap that has been fed out and held fast. The fibers that are not held fast are removed by the half lap and collected as waste. These short fibers may be recycled and used elsewhere in a less critical yarn. The combed webs are condensed back into sliver and coiled into a can for temporary storage and transport to subsequent processing. The reasons for combing vary greatly depending on the end product, but generally it is done to increase the yarn count range of the material being processed. A finer yarn can be made from combed cotton, which tends to result in an end product with extra sheen, drape, and hand. Combed yarns and the resulting products tend to be softer and yield more durability. From an engineering standpoint, combing may be required for some yarn counts and some end product performance standards. For other end products, it may just be a price point decision.
Okay, so once we know that how a comber actually works, let us see what kind of feed a comber would expect. So from the above discussion, one can see that the feed to the comber must be in the form of a lap. So this is the image of how the lap would look like. So this is what is our aim. When we say that we need a comber preparatory, so the first function of the comber preparatory would be produce a lap like this, which can be then easily fed to the comber. So what else is the would be the requirement in the comber lap? So the importance of feeding parallelized fibers. So feeding a parallelized tuft to the comber in the form of a lap is very important, and let us see why it is so important. So in the figure that is shown here, what you see is it's a top view of the nipper. So if you remember from our previous discussion, the nipper is the first grip that we have given before the combing, the first combing takes place. So this is a top view of the nipper. If nipper is nothing but a plate on which these fibers are there would be another plate which would be on the top, which would be gripping this at this line. So what you see here is some fibers that are projecting out, and there is a comber lap here before this, which will be opened. The sheet comes here and the sheet is opened out. So some fibers would be protruding out from this particular nipper grip. So these are held in the grip while some fibers that are released from the grip. So now you can see both types of fibers. There are some fibers which are still held in the nip, if this you consider as a nip line. Then there are some fibers which have already been released. Some of them are moving towards the this line, which is known as a detaching roller nip. Now this detaching roller nip would be the second grip. So now we see here two types of fibers. One is fiber A and fiber B. Now first let us look at the fiber B. Fiber B that is shown here is the short fiber, and as you can see, it has been already released by the nipper grip, and it is unable to reach the detaching roller nip. That means it is still somewhere in between and it has not reached. And this particular fiber or such fibers would be definitely be combed, because there's a cylinder below over here, and the cylinder will just comb it and remove these such short fibers by combing. And these will land up in the noil. Noil is a special name for waste at comber, and this normally consists of short fibers which we remove during combing. So now we can see that there is another fiber that is marked as A over here. Again, this is not there gripped by the detaching roller yet. and because the distance is so much, it is but one important difference that you see here is that it is lying in a slanted manner over here. It has been released already, and again this particular fiber will also not be able to reach the detaching roller nip, because not because of its length, that means not because it is short in length, but because it is lying in this certain manner over here. If this same fiber were to be lying straight, then probably it would have reached the detaching roller nip. So that is what is being said here, that but such a fiber, in spite of being long enough, might land up in the noil just because it has not been parallelized. This would mean unnecessary loss of good fibers. So from this entire discussion, we come to know that it is better that this fiber would have been parallelized, or rather been parallel to the remaining fibers, and in that manner it would have been able to reach the detaching roller, which would avoid loss of good fibers. So from this discussion, we conclude that the comber preparatory must feed parallelized fibers to the comber, which can be achieved only by drafting. One may have one or two machines for drafting the carded sliver and achieve good parallelization. So we can have between, as we saw in comber, we need comber preparatory, which could be one machine or it could be two machines. So let us go into that discussion in some time shortly. Before that, let us try and understand what are fiber hooks. So there are these different types of hooks which are shown in the diagram, and this is the direction of movement of the material. If the material is moving in this direction, only then along the direction of movement of the material, the fibers have hooks at the back. It is known as trailing. So this is a fiber which has got a hook at the back, so it is called as a trailing hook. And if the hook is in the front, it is known as a leading hook. So if the direction of movement is this, then such a fiber would be called as a trailing hook, and this fiber which has got a hook in the front would be called as a leading hook. Then there may be other fibers which have hooks on both sides, so they are doubled hooks. And just for comparison, this particular straight fiber is shown. So as you can see, if this hook were to be opened out, then in that case you would have a straightened fiber which is longer than the hooked fiber. So now let us go a little bit back into our processing line and see what was the situation in the carding machine. What kind of hooks did it produce? So in the carding machine, this is the cylinder and this is a doffer. So as you can see, this red thing is that is shown, it is a fiber here. It is leading because this is the direction of motion of the cylinder and the hook is in the front. So this is a leading hook over here. But when it is taken by the doffer, now doffer would be moving in this direction. This fiber just gets transferred under doffer in the same way. And as this is going down, you find that this hook has got transformed into a trailing hook. So most of the fibers that are delivered by the doffer would be trailing in nature. So let us have a look at what kind of percentage of trailing hooks are delivered. Over 50% of the fibers in the card web exhibit trailing hooks, whereas 15% would be leading hooks and 15% would be double hooks. And only a small proportion are delivered without any hook or deformation of any kind. So this small proportion would be okay with us, but this 50% that are coming out as a trailing hook, our major focus should be on somehow taking care of these kind of hooks. And so what is the remedy for this, or how we can tackle this problem? Why we don't want hooks is because we saw that if the hook were opened, then this hook would be, if it no longer existed, then the fiber would be straight and it would be longer in length. And such a fiber would, you can see, it can easily reach the detaching roller. So hooks are supposed to be removed, and this can be done in comber preparatory if we have some kind of knowledge about which kind of hooks are preferable. If at all hooks are going to be there, then which would be better. So let us have a look at leading and trailing hooks. Now fibers are moving from the nipper grip line, that is a nipper grip line over here, to the detaching roller. So fibers are moving in the downward direction like this. So again we see two types of fibers, one is A and B. A, since this is a direction, A would be known as a trailing hook and B is the leading hook. So now we look at a leading hook. A leading hook is in a better position to be combed because the cylinder is somewhere here in between. The cylinder would open out, this particular hook is in a better position to open this. Whereas when you look at this particular fiber, this is still gripped, so the cylinder cannot open it. A trailing hook that is gripped by the nipper is more likely to be combed by the cylinder to be eliminated as noil, since it has not been able to reach the detaching roller nip. So this particular fiber is more likely to go as noil. So from this particular discussion, we understand that we conclude that the comber preparatory must feed leading hooks to the comber, and since 50% of the fibers in the carded web are trailing hooks, we must focus on these trailing hooks to feed them as leading hooks. So our primary aim should be, these two should be kept in mind whenever we go for comber preparatory. So now comes the question whether we should have one passage or whether we should have two passages for as comber preparatory. So the question of having one or two passages of drafting between card and comber will be decided by the hook position, which we have just discussed at the feed to comber. So we come to this card can, which is there. Now we already know that 50% of the fibers delivered by the card are trailing in nature. So we let us focus on these orange colored fibers here and see how these change their position as soon as a process is added. So 50% of the fibers in the card web are trailing hooks, which is shown in orange here. So these fibers enter the card can as trailing hooks. As you can see, it is moving in the downward direction as it is being coiled into the card can, and this would be going in as a trailing hook. But as soon as it comes for withdrawal, when the fiber is going to be withdrawn for feeding to the next process, it would be going as a leading hook. Since this is a direction of movement, it would go out as a leading hook. And it will be also fed as a leading hook to the next, whatever machine that we are going to feed it to. If at all this machine is not able to remove the hooks by drafting, then in that case, if this hook remains, it will remain as a leading hook. These leading hooks are then coming out and going into the package, whatever is being made by this particular machine, and it will go in as a leading hook, as you can see over here. And while exiting, the same fiber would exit as a trailing hook. You can see over here. So now, can I feed this particular material, which would have approximately 50% of the fibers as trailing hooks? Why trailing hooks? Because this is the 50% of the trailing hooks that were there in the card web. So the same would be reflected here if the hooks are not reduced. Then in that case, I would be feeding to the next machine the material in the form of a trailing hook. But can I feed this directly to the comber? The answer would be no. From the previous discussion, we have concluded that whatever hooks need to be fed to the comber should be leading hooks, so that it is able to open them out very easily. So therefore, even if I understand that enough draft can be applied in the first passage to achieve good parallelization, which was our first point, I cannot feed this output of the first passage to the comber, because the majority hooks fed would be trailing. And as if I feed trailing hooks, it will lead to an increase in noil. So what I do is I add one more machine in comber preparatory. And now let us look at this particular situation. This was a trailing hook. This trailing hook goes into the machine as a trailing hook. If nothing happens to it, it will come out. And in the when it is going into the can, you can see it is going as trailing only. But when it will exit from this particular package that the second preparatory machine would give, it will come out as a leading hook. So now this particular material, I'm very comfortable in feeding it to the comber, because I'm sure that it will be able to open them out. So therefore, we see that one more passage is needed, so that after the second passage, majority of the fibers exiting the final output package would be in the leading hook position. And now it is appropriate to feed them to the comber. So the summary of this entire discussion would be that in comber preparatory, first is that I would need to prepare a lap. Secondly, the Comber preparatory has to draft so that the fibers are parallelized, the reason we have seen earlier. Also, I will be requiring definitely two Comber preparatory passages, so that when I feed the fibers to the Comber, they are fed as leading hooks. So we must take care of this. So now, what is the importance of pre-comb draft? So whenever I'm applying or drafting during the Comber preparatory on both the passages or both the machines of Comber preparatory, so what exactly am I achieving here? So let us have a look at this particular graph here, where it is showing on the x-axis draft is being shown and on the y-axis noil percentage is being shown. We see that as the draft value increases, there is a decrease in the noil percentage. That means I'm reducing the waste percentage over here. So let us take a look here. From the graph, it is seen that as the draft is increased, the noil goes on decreasing. This is a result of a combined effect of increased parallelization. We have seen once the fibers are all parallelized, the longer fiber would be able to reach the detaching roller nib and would be saved from going into the noil. So this is one effect because of which the noil percentage would reduce. And also we saw that if we have two machines, then I would reduce the number of hooks over here. Or rather, I would feed leading hooks, and in that case, again, I will see a reduction in noil. So by taking these small steps over here, that is by having a drafting, good drafting to achieve parallelization in Comber preparatory, as well as having two machines for doing this job of drafting, would help me feed the material as leading hooks to the Comber. So now let us come to the importance of doubling and evenness in the lab. So the Comber preparatory not only has to take care that it feeds parallel fibers along with leading hooks, but it has also to see that whatever feed is being done, it is even in certain ways. So now let us discuss on this. If card slivers, if we just take and we were to simply feed it to the Comber, by just keeping them side by side in the form of a sheet, good grip would be exercised only as shown here. So if you see this, I consider these circles as a card sliver. This is the top nipper plate. This is the bottom nipper plate, which is going to grip the slivers. What we see is the maximum pressure that is applied is at the top here, wherever the sliver is being held by the top nipper. So this would, at the top, highest peak over here, it will be the location of high pressure. Whereas in between the slivers, where this nippers are not able to exercise enough grip, these are the locations of all these places over here would be, in the center would be location of low pressure. So what exactly happens is, the nippers would not be able to hold the fibers at the edges of the sliver. So if this is an edge of the sliver, this is the front view where we are seeing the top nipper, bottom nipper and the sliver. So the sliver, that is the fibers that are there at the edge here, would not be gripped properly, and because of that they would be pulled out by the cylinder, which is going to come next in the process line for Comber. So therefore the fed lap must be extremely uniform in thickness along the width. So along the width, if this were to be flat here, then this would be an ideal material to be have been fed to the Comber, so that there is uniform gripping. So now we come to the point or the aim that your Comber preparatory should take care that whatever lap it forms, it should be uniform in thickness along the width. The reason being that it should be uniformly gripped by the nippers at Comber. So to summarize this entire lecture or the objects of Comber preparatory over here, so once the requirements of the Comber are known, the lap can be prepared accordingly. So a preparatory should be working in the direction where we should understand the requirements of the Comber and accordingly do the preparation. So the first requirement that we saw was we need to feed a lap to the Comber. So the lap has to be fed. So the lap has to be wound under pressure so that a stable lap can be produced. And the lap will also be of predetermined length. So these are some features that the lap should possess. The fibers in the feed lap must be parallel and free of hooks. We have seen the reasons. We also saw that leading hooks only should be fed to the comber because they are easily removed. And then the lap must be uniform along its length and width so that you have enough grip so that the fibers are not unnecessarily plucked out and wasted as oil. So this is the summary. And so now what is the way out to do all this, especially in case of doubling? So there are two kinds of doubling that we would see. One is the doubling of sliver and the doubling of lap. So let us understand, when we say we are doubling the slivers, then what exactly is happening? The lap that is being fed to the comber must also be uniform along its length. So we already know that if we keep the slivers side by side and double them, they would the thick and thin places in the adjacent slivers would try to even out, and we will get a uniform output sliver. But this uniformity will be along the length. So, but then our lap needs to be uniform both along the length as well as the width. This uniformity along the length is achieved by doubling the slivers. When you keep slivers side by side, you will get that this particular uniformity. But if you have to get the uniformity along the width, then you will have to do one more thing. The uniformity of lap along the length can be achieved by doubling the card sliver, as we saw, and you can produce a sheet. But if you, once the lap is formed, then which is formed on the first comber preparatory machine, the laps can be doubled. That means you can stack one lap sheet upon the other and so on. So you will get a stack of laps, which would then help us in achieving the evenness along the width. So this second comber preparatory machine could be a machine which would double the laps. So your first comber preparatory could be some machine which would do the doubling for the slivers, which are coming from the card. And the second comber preparatory machine could be a machine which would double the laps so that we get uniformity along the width. So both these kinds of uniformity are important from the point of view of getting a uniform sliver output from comber. So a comber preparatory has to do all these or perform all these functions. So coming to the, once we know that we need two machines before comber. So this was our passage. We had a card, then we had first comber preparatory, second comber preparatory, then comber, and then roving frame. This would be a draw frame. Then sixth would be the roving frame and the ring frame. So this entire passage we have seen. Now let us go into a little bit detail and see in conventional lap preparation, which were the machines that were there. And let us compare them to the modern lap preparation. So let us have a look at the conventional processing line. The one is the card. The two is here is a sliver lap machine. Third is the ribbon lap machine. Fourth is the comber. Fifth is the draw frame, which would be there. And sixth would be the roving frame. And seventh would be the ring frame. So this is your conventional or the traditional processing line if you want to produce a combed sliver. So basically, comber lap preparation would be sliver lap and ribbon lap. Now let us compare this with the modern. In the modern, again there will be two machines, but after card there would be a pre-comb draw frame. It would be a normal draw frame, but this name has been given so that we understand that this is we are doing this for combing. So a pre-comb draw frame will be there. After that, there will be a lap forming machine, which is marked as 3 over here. Then again, you will have a comber. Of course, after going from the comber, it will go on to a draw frame, roving frame and ring frame. The normal processing line would follow. So when you look at the modern lap preparation, it would be a pre-comb draw frame and a lap forming machine before comber. So in the older conventional or the traditional lap preparation, sliver lap, ribbon lap. And in the modern, it would be a draw frame and a lap forming machine. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. Thank you.